The second speaker is the director of the Education and Social Stratification Strand of AQMeN, Professor Cristina Iannelli. I have had the privilege to work with Cristina over many years, and I cannot imagine my own research having gone forward in the last decade or two without working with Cristina. Tremendously interesting person in her research. So, Cristina.
First of all, I would like to thank you for coming to this event. I'm actually delighted to see so many people from also different institutions with different roles, with different interests in our research. It's really, really great to see so much interest. This other part of the story that I'm going to tell is very much connected with what Imar has just presented. Analyzing the Scottish School Leaver Survey and the Irish School Leaver Survey, we couldn't look at what happens prior to the final examination in the final years of secondary school, because the Irish survey was structured in a way which didn't allow us to look at prior choices of subjects when, for example, people finish compulsory education. So we looked for other data for actually analyzing this kind of choices in Scotland, and we found a new source, which I recommend very highly, which is the Scottish Longitudinal Study, which are administrative data. These are data which come from census data and also data from Scottish Qualification Authority for the education part of the data, which are incredibly rich and very, very informative in the kind of research we are carrying out. So, just a background, why we were interested in subject choice within Scotland and also within Ireland, because most UK studies have tend to focus very much on attainment, and most UK studies, especially on social inequalities in education, center on attainment differences. And again, here we don't want to discard the problem that there is an attainment problem and an attainment gap, but we need to think that the story is much more complex and it's not just about attainment. Of course, there has been a lot of also research at the international level on the role of curriculum in different school systems, but most of this international literature has focused on the division between the vocational tracks and the academic tracks, which somehow has diverted attention to the differentiation you can find within educational programs like the Scottish one, which are mostly general, where there is also a vocational component, of course, but not as strong as in a track system like the German system or the Austrian system or other similar type of dual systems. So we realized there was a gap there. There was clearly less attention paid to within school curriculum difference within the more kind of generalistic system. So our study tried to advance upon that and to provide evidence on social inequalities in subject choices within general education system like the Scottish system. We asked quite simple question, I would say, but I think they are still telling a very important story here. Do subject choices in S3, S4 for the international participants, S3, S4 are practically final 2 years of compulsory schooling in Scotland, so lower secondary, what the international literature would define as lower secondary education. So do subject choices in S3, S4 vary among pupils from different social backgrounds? And are their social differences also in subject choice in S5, S6? But what we are interested, because we knew already there were these differences from Imar's talk, is what's the relationship? So to what extent are social differences in subject choice in S5, S6 explained by subject choices in S3 and S4? So what's the relationship between these two time points in which people have to make choices of curriculum? And are there remaining differences, social class differences, which cannot be explained by the subject choice taken, you know, in S3, S4, or also attainment or in these subjects in earlier years? It's important to ask the third question, because to sit an exam in S5 and S6, there is no statutory requirements in the Scottish system to have previously sat the same subject in S3 and S4. So apparently there is some flexibility of people picking up a subject later on in the final 2 years of secondary school. But I'm saying, apparently, because theoretically this is possible, but I'm going to show you that in practice this happens very rarely. So, as I said, we are using a very good new data set, which I would like to say just a few words about, the Scottish Longitudinal Study. Practically, these are administrative data from various sources which are linked together, and in this case, what we are focused on are information from Census 2001, which give us information about the family background of the people we are analyzing in this study. And also, we want to, of course, look at their attainment and their subject choices in the between S3 and S6, so we can actually follow and know how well they did and what kind of choice they made at standard grades and higher. I have to say I'm referring to the old system now of standard grade hires, because those years were the years in which standard grades were still in place. So census data, education data come from the Scottish Qualification Authority, attainment data and attendance data as well, and also we have data from the school census. Then we have data from census data, so 2001 in this case, which provide information about pupils' family background, but also housing, neighborhood characteristics when people were aged 9 and 10. And we, of course, carried out our analysis on around 5,000 cases in a safe setting at the National Records of Scotland. So here are first results. These are very descriptive, so these are just percentage of people taking different subjects by social background characteristics. I'm putting up only the results for parental social class and parental education. I'll focus in my talk on parental education because we found the parental education has a much stronger effect on subject choice than parental social class, but we can see also in this just descriptive statistics there are sharp differences in young people's choices of subjects. So at S3 and S4, all people take English and maths compulsory, so there is no variation there because everybody has to take those two subjects. But then there are large differences among young people from different social backgrounds in taking, for example, a science subject. So we have people with parents with no qualification, usually 70% of them take a science subject versus almost totality of people who come from a family with both parents with a degree. And this kind of difference are replicated also for other subjects like languages. We have grouped the kind of more humanity subjects and under cultural studies, which include history, geography, arts, modern studies together. And we found that for this third group, differences are there, but are less marked than for the previous two science and languages, the previous two subjects. And interestingly, I think, when we look at other subjects, and here we are talking about more applied subjects, vocationally oriented subjects, we have the opposite pattern, that people from less educated parents or from lower social classes tend to take the subject more than people from middle-class families or from highly educated parents. So we have the inverse pattern here for this kind of subjects. Of course, these are descriptive statistics, which means that they don't take into account other potential differences among young people, these young people. So what we did then is to run a statistical analysis, which we take into account other characteristics of young people to see whether these differences still are there, whether they still emerge in our data. So similarly to what also Imar presented, these are percentage point differences in the probability, in this case, of choosing subjects, different types of subjects, in S3 and S4 for people coming from families with parents with different types of qualification. Here the comparison is between those who have parents with a degree and those who have parents with no qualification at all. And we found that there are still significant differences between these groups in taking both science, languages, and smaller, as I said, but also in cultural studies, we found social class differences. But as I saw in the descriptives, we have an inverse pattern. So this negative sign, minus 20, means that people from highly educated parents are less likely to take more vocationally oriented subject than people from parents with no qualifications, so less educated parents. So next step is let's look at uptake of subject in S5 and S6. Here we found, again, similar results from the ones presented, S3 and S4, only the difference are even more sharp. They are even more marked than before. So we have now also English and maths in our table, because now this we know that English and maths can be dropped after S4. So these are people who have chosen to continue studying English and maths. And we see there are stark differences between the people who, again, come from families with parents with no qualifications. So only 45% of them continue studying English, even less, 38% study maths, while we have 91% of people with parents with degrees studying English, and 74% of them also going on studying maths. And now, at this stage, we don't see any difference, social class difference, in relation to these other subjects, the kind of more vocationally oriented subjects. And again, then we decided to, of course, take into account also other characteristics. I forgot to say which one are the other characteristics we took into account. Their gender, ethnicity, other also information we have about housing, for example, there is something else, sorry, it just slipped out from my mind, but I'll check my notes 1 second to remember which one was the... other characteristic we look at. Yes, number of siblings. So we were looking also at the family composition to make sure that, again, we were not missing out some difference which were crucial to understand why subject choice varied across different groups. So taking into account this other characteristic, we still find very strong difference in subject choice, and as I said, even higher now difference in subject choice, S5 and 6. So what was before something around 18% difference has become now in science, has become now 29% difference in the taking up of these subjects among people from different family backgrounds. And no difference, as I said, in the group's other subjects. So the next slide is also key to demonstrate how strong the relationship is between S3, S4, and S5, S6, the choice made in these at these two time points. So the first column is telling us the percentage of people who are taking the different subjects, so science, languages, cultural study, or other subjects in S5, S6. Then we have also the percentage of people who sat subject in the same subject in S3, S4. In this case, 52% of those who sat science subject, for example, in S3, S4, also took the same subject in S5, S6. But what is more important, in my opinion, is to look at the percentage of people who did not sit the exam before S5, S6. So for science, only 5% actually took up a science subject in S5, S6, not having sit an exam in science previously. So there is a clear, strong relationship between the choice made at the end of compulsory education and at the end of secondary education overall. And these percentages are also small for languages and cultural subjects. There is a bit more variation when we look again at other subjects, so people tend to choose other subjects, more likely to choose other subjects later on, even though they haven't sat the same exam previously. So, in summary, we found strong social inequalities in subject choice in S3, S4. We find a big divide between the science, the languages, and the cultural study on one side, which are clearly mostly chosen by middle-class children, versus the other subjects, which are mostly business, technical, or vocational subjects, which are mostly chosen by less advanced social groups. The findings of subject choice in S3 and S4 are mainly reproduced in S5 and S6, and we have found there is a strong social inequalities also in maths and English, which were compulsory in S3 and S4, but they are not in S5 and S6. Subject choice in S3 and S4 also are strong predictor of subject choice in S5 and S6, which explain, in this way, we can explain also social class differences in later choices. If they haven't chosen those subjects in S3, S4, there is no chance, there is little chance that people will take up those subjects later on. And there is a modest effect of social origin on subject choice in S5 and S6 once we take into account this previous choice and also attainment within those choices. So what are the implications for policies? There is no doubt when we look at especially the international literature that Scotland has not a track system in terms of formal tracking as we found in other education systems. However, the patterns we have seen does resonate a bit of tracking. So does resonate the fact that certain groups seem to be taking subjects which are usually considered more suitable for them, which are the vocational subjects within the school system, within a system which is very general in its content, much more general than other systems. So we need to make sure that we are aware that there is selection of school subjects which is socially patterned. Then we also need to think that allowing people to drop academic subjects too early is also detrimental for young people's prospect of entering higher education, but also of finding a good job, because higher education leads also to better jobs afterwards. Clearly, key message is that we need to provide clear information and support in curriculum choices in the crucial years of secondary education as a way of improving, as well as improving education attainment. So the two things have to go together. We don't have to forget that within our education system, it's not just attainment which matters, as Imar has just shown, but also the choice of subject are key for entering higher education, especially the most prestigious or high status universities in the country. That's it, thank you.